Tá na hora do Jair ir embora. Vá-se embora, vá-se embora. Hi, hello, how's it going? It's low. This is not actual wine. This is just grape juice because I got so drunk. I got so drunk. I got so drunk when Lula won that I don't think I want to touch a glass of wine for the foreseeable future. And by the foreseeable future, I mean until the actual. Oh, let me take off my glasses. But to the foreseeable future, I actually mean until the inauguration. I'm gonna get so fucking pissed then too. But no matter how bad you think I was, my mom was worse. My mom was way worse.
O meu presidente é Luiz Inácio Lula da Silva.
We reunite here today to talk about something that happened in Brazil in the last couple of weeks. If you've been following me on Twitter or in any social media, or if you've been following the news, you know that Brazil did something that American leftists thought it was impossible for such a backwards country in the third world, which is voting out a fascist from office. Also, what do you guys think of this new background? Like, I'm still working around my new room, trying to find the best places to film. Now I get my shelves, which are not the most tidy, but you know, who has tidy shelves in this economy? I'm still trying to work out what's the best place for filming. This is by far the most comfortable. But let's see how it works. Messing around with the camera angle still. But yeah, it's been like 3 weeks at this point, almost a month, and I'm still 100% in the mood of.
Meu presidente é Luiz Inácio Lula da Silva.
So this was an election, and this is why I want to talk about this today, not just because I'm extremely relieved that Bolsonaro is no longer my president. And I say that he's no longer my president because he hasn't been seen in like 3 weeks, and I haven't heard from him in like 3 weeks. I haven't been forced to listen to him drawl on for 3 fucking weeks. This is a fucking miracle. But anyway, the reason why I want to discuss the Brazilian elections is not only because of how happy and relieved I am that it happened and it ended the way that it did, but I think that we should recognize that this was an election in a bid that could have gone very, very wrong. And if it went very, very wrong, it would lead to some very fucked up consequences too. And so what I want to discuss is that the Brazilian elections were not only important for the Brazilian democracy, they were important for the world as a whole. And not only that, the results that we got were only possible because we have done years upon years upon years of community and base organizing. But more importantly, this election only worked out because of the figure of Luiz Inácio Lula da Silva. And so today, I want to talk about the Brazilian elections. What do they mean, and what can we as the whole world learn from them? Before we start, however, here's a quick disclaimer. If you're wondering, huh, are you just yet another American talking about Brazil? Like, no, I'm Brazilian. I'm born and raised in Brazil. I still currently live in Brazil. I am in this moment as we speak, I am speaking from Brazil. So that is one thing. I know what the fuck I'm talking about. Second thing is that this is a leftist video. This is a video for leftists, or this is a video for people who are, you know, sympathizers with the idea of the left. If you're a far right or a right-wing person, you're not gonna like this video, nor you're gonna like the analysis that I'm going to make. That is not my fucking problem, so you can see yourself out. And se você é bolsominion, contar uma coisa para vocês, que é o seguinte: meu YouTube não é uma democracia. Então eu não sou obrigada a aturar marmanjo falando com as bolas do Bolsonaro atochada inteiramente no. If you're still in that group that I mentioned before, you can also see yourself out. Click the little X up above. Go see, find something else that you can, someone else that you can bother. It's not gonna be me. So if any of those people comment something like, "This guy is a thief. He's a corrupt. He blah 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 blah," you're going to be blocked and muted. Again, my social media isn't a democracy. And so you guys are just gonna have to deal with that. Okay? Okay. That small bit of housekeeping aside, this video is going to be divided into five different sections. The first is the context before the election. The second is the election itself. And then in the third part, we're going to discuss the differences between the Brazilian 2022 election and the Brazil and the American 2020 election. We're going to discuss what can we learn from the Lula election and also what can we expect from the third Lula mandate. So I want to do a quick overview of Brazilian elections, their impact, not only in Brazil, but for the world, and what can we as a left both learn from it and expect from it. So that is basically the video. Also, real quick, I'm going to condense the shit out of the story because it's very, very long and I don't have time to get into all of the details. If you speak Portuguese, please listen to the podcast Medo e Delírio em Brasília. Se você fala português, tá, nossa, Luísa, seu vídeo tá parecendo um pouco com Medo e Delírio. Medo e Delírio foi a única razão pela qual me mantive sã durante o período eleitoral. Eu sou simplesmente a maior fã de Medo e Delírio que existe, então vocês todos vão ter que lidar com o fato de que eu farei algumas inserções parecidas com Medo e Delírio. Então, é isso, tá bom? Ok. Our story here begins in 1964. No, just kidding. our story here begins in 2016 with a coup of then-president Dilma Rousseff. This was a constitutional coup who was financed by, you guessed it, America, fuck yeah! The land of the free and the brave. This was a coup that was founded on this sentiment of anti-corruption. There was this widespread movement or pull towards purging corruption charges from the government, almost as if the biggest problem of Brazil was indeed corruption. And this is a type of rhetoric that stuck around for a long time and still sticks around still. But around that time, around 2016 to 2018, the rhetoric of anti-corruption was one of the strongest political motors of the public sphere. And so what we need to understand is that after 2016, when President Dilma was outed on corruption charges, but it wasn't really corruption charges because she didn't even lose her political rights. And so if she were convicted of being a corrupt official or being a corrupt president, she would have her political rights suspended, which did not happen. So basically, they just assumed that it was a coup. However, this rhetoric was strongly aided by a judicial operation called Operation Car Wash. And this operation became very renowned and very famous for going after major figures of the Workers' Party, which is the party of Lula and Dilma. Specifically, this was an operation that became known for going after then ex-president Luiz Inácio Lula da Silva. They investigated his entire life, gifts that he has gotten, apartments that he looked after. It was a whole thing. And this operation was headed by Juiz Sérgio Moro, or Judge Sérgio Moro, who is known as the most lipless man known to mankind. Anyway, from 2016 to 2018, a lot of things happened. And when Bolsonaro won in 2018, Sérgio Moro became his Minister of Justice. So you can see just how impartial and detached of a judge he was from the case that he was trying to judge, right? Why did he become the Minister of Justice? This is an interesting story. In 2018, right before Bolsonaro was elected, Lula was also a runner in the presidential election. Lula knew in 2018, as he knows now, or he knew now, that he was almost sort of like the only one who could beat Bolsonaro. And he was planning on running again just so that Bolsonaro wouldn't be elected. Sérgio Moro had him arrested in 2018 on these very flimsy corruption charges that didn't stand up and don't stand up still when you hold them to scrutiny.
Não adiantam tentar evitar que eu ande por esse país. Porque tem milhões e milhões de Lulas, de Bolo, de Manuela, de Dilma Rousseff para andar por mim. Não adianta tentar acabar, sabe, com as minhas ideias. elas já estão pairando no ar e não tem como prendê-las. Não adianta tentar parar o meu sonho, porque quando eu parar de sonhar, eu sonharei pela cabeça de vocês e pelo dono de vocês. Não adianta achar que tudo vai parar o dia que o Lula tiver infarte. É bobagem, porque o meu coração baterá pelo coração de vocês, e são milhões de corações. Os poderosos podem matar uma, duas ou três rosas, mas jamais conseguirão deter a chegada da primavera. E a nossa luta é em busca da primavera.
The Supreme Court also considered not keeping Lula in jail, but they were threatened by an off-duty army general on Twitter. And I fucking wish I was making this up. It was ridiculous. Anyway, in 2018, what happened was that Lula wanted to run. He couldn't run because he was unlawfully, I would say, arrested. And when he was arrested, he had a substitute, and that substitute was Fernando Haddad. Now, I think Fernando Haddad is a lovely person. I think that he, you know, is a great professor. He's very smart. He has the charisma of a carrot. That's the problem with everyone who comes from São Paulo. Like, people don't have charisma, and Lula by himself is an extremely charismatic person. Like, Lula managed to convince the people who are holding over him in jail to vote for the Workers' Party. That's just how charismatic he is. And so for you to have Lula, and then you have Haddad, who's like the anti-charisma, like, it wouldn't work out. We knew that it wouldn't work out, and we knew from the beginning that this was an election that was lost, but more importantly, this was an election that was unlawfully disturbed, because if things had happened the way they were supposed to, maybe we wouldn't have been stuck with Bolsonaro for 4 years. So with all of that, Lula was arrested in 2018, Bolsonaro got elected in 2018, Sergio Moro became Bolsonaro's Minister of Justice in 2019. What he wanted was to be appointed a Supreme Court justice. And so I think that he made all of that as a way to get to the point where he would be appointed a Supreme Court justice. And that just highlights the type of person that was heading Lula's trial and just how impartial it was. If you're wondering about the charges and the quality of the charges. Also, he doesn't know how to speak Portuguese very well. He's not a foreigner. He's just stupid. And I will stress on the fact that he has no lips, because I think that in his case, that's a flaw of his character. So, however, 2018, the Supreme Court actually reverses Lula's arrest, and eventually they clear him of all charges because they recognize that Moro was not an impartial judge in the case, and that actually affected the way that the case was conducted. And in the meantime, while all of this was happening, between Lula being freed from jail in 2019 and Lula being considered eligible in 2021, between all of that, there was this thing happening while Bolsonaro was president, allegedly. There was also something going on in the background. Maybe you guys heard from it. It's a global pandemic. Okay, that happened. Bolsonaro's handling of the pandemic was abysmal. It was dismal. It was really bad. I'm talking deliberately not buying vaccines because they don't work. I'm talking not issuing mask mandates because of freedom. I'm talking suing mayors and governors who actually did some sort of work trying to contain the pandemic for doing their fucking jobs. I'm talking imitating and making fun of people choking to death with COVID. I'm talking saying, what do you want me to do? I don't work in a graveyard when asked to comment the amount of people who had died by COVID on the previous day. And also, I'm talking trying to offer hydroxychloroquine to a fucking emu twice and being bitten. The more I remember the shit that actually went down in this government, the more I'm like, how the fuck did I survive that? Like, how? I don't know how. Like, how could we survive that? I lived 4 years of this insanity. This motherfucker stole a dog. Like, this... Damn, I really wish this was wine. Anyway, his handling of the pandemic was shit. But so was his handling of the economy. Because his handling of the pandemic was shit. So when 700,000 people die because of COVID, it's not like your economy is going to be bustling, right? It doesn't take a genius to realize that. But Bolsonaro isn't even that. We all know how clever that man is. That he got bitten by an emu twice, okay? So things right now, in economy-wise, are not very good in Brazil. Inflation is skyrocketing. People are very food insecure. The price of food specifically has gone, like, skyrocketed in the past couple of years. And it's been very difficult to try to keep oneself fed. Like, it's heartbreaking. Because I remember when I was a kid, before Lula was president, I would see, and we would see a lot of people begging for food and begging for shelter and begging for, like, turning trash cans, trying to find something to eat. And during the Lula years, that went down significantly. And so it was very rare that we would see people actually being hungry, that because Lula took Brazil off of the hunger map of the UN. And so, but Brazil actually went back to the hunger map of the UN. And we currently have 33 million people who are food insecure in Brazil. And there is this picture, it was so heartbreaking, of people turning over like carcasses to get the bones, to boil them in order to have something to eat because they had nothing. Like, they couldn't afford any protein. And that was the only protein that they could get. And this was something that I saw when I was a kid and I thought that I would never see again. And it's heartbreaking that I'm seeing again. And the reason why I'm seeing again is because Bolsonaro's handling of the economy is abyssal, like I said, just as his handling of COVID was. I think that the worst part is knowing that things didn't have to be like this. And that things didn't need to be this bad. And I know that they didn't need to be this bad because they weren't this bad before. But I also know that things didn't have to be like this. And the reason why they are is because of the elites of this country coming together and deciding that they didn't want this metal worker guy, Northeasterner migrant, to actually work for the people who needed the most. They wanted people who would work for them to maximize their own profits, and that was it. And so this is heartbreaking. This is the heartbreaking part. And so they voted for the guy who killed 700,000 people and then would steal a dog in his off hours, which are plenty. He only works like 4 hours a day. When I say that these 4 years have been hell. Also, if you're wondering, yes, I don't think anyone has ever told Bolsonaro that he's not supposed to deep throat Trump's dick. Bolsonaro's government had abysmal approval rates, and Lula was winning at every poll, and thus we walked into the 2022 elections with Bolsonaro being very much aware that he was going to lose this election. It was clear from the polls, from the reactions of the media, that he was not going to be president in the forthcoming years. But here is the issue. Bolsonaro has never been without an elected mandate for the past 28 years. And this guy has done some shit. And the moment that he doesn't have parliamentary immunity anymore, he's fucked. So he knew that he was going to lose, and he knew that he was going to get fucked once he left the presidency. And thus begins the election madness 2022. Before we get to the actual insanity of this election cycle, let me just explain to you guys very quickly how election in Brazil works. Basically, voting in Brazil is only optional to those between 16 and 17, and also those older than 70 years old, and compulsory for everyone between the ages of 18 to 69. Brazilians have voted electronically since 1996 in one of the most widely regarded and respected voting systems in the world. With her, ladies and gentlemen, the electronic ballot. Since ballots are cast electronically and each party is allotted a number, this is why you might see Workers' Party propaganda with the number 13 on it. This is because this is a number allotted to the Workers' Party, and each party has its own number. And so if you're voting for president, you only vote the party number. So if you're voting for Lula, you would press 13 on the electronic ballot. But if you're voting, let's say, for a senator, you're going to need three digits. So let's say that you would going to vote 13, which is a party number, and then a 0 or a 1. These numbers are allotted to specific candidates, but they're all following behind the number that is allotted to the party. And this is why you may see ads and propaganda and etc. With the 13 on it, because of the electronic ballot. Voting always happens on a Sunday, and people who work Sundays have to be given time off in order to be able to vote. Electoral laws are national and can only be amended by the National Congress. Elections are organized by the Superior Electoral Court, which is made of 7 members, 3 of which are members of the Brazilian Supreme Court, whose president is none other than Alexandre de Moraes.
Xandão.
We're going to talk more about him in a second. Anyway, starting this year, public transportation is free in major cities. That includes subways and bus fares. And some states also forbid the selling of alcohol during election hours. So from the 10 p.m. Saturday to 10 p.m. Sunday, alcohol is forbidden. This was a year where most states didn't actually implement that. It was the first time that happened. I'm not sure if that had any impact, but if I come across any study showing that this actually had any impact on the voting, I will let you guys know. Usually you're assigned to the polls closest to your house, and that is usually a school. So you usually vote in schools and the one that is closer to where you live. So you're assigned schools based on your location. When the polls close, the ballots will release a receipt, and this receipt will actually be matched with the number of people who actually voted. And if the numbers match, then that data will be sent over to the Superior Electoral Court for counting. Results will usually come out around 8 p.m., which is when the last polls open in the world, such as in California or Vancouver, will close. After you vote, you receive a receipt for your own control. And if you don't vote, your social security gets suspended and you can't open bank accounts. There's a lot of stuff that you can't do if you don't vote. Elections are unified, so every 4 years, we'll vote for president, governor, senator, state representative, and federal representative. What we would call midterms in Brazil happens every 4 years, but in between the voting for president. So we vote every 2 years, and that's just elections for mayors and city council members. If no candidate of either president or governor reaches 50% plus one of the vote, then the election will go to the runoffs. This happened this year. We're gonna get to it. So basically, this is how the Brazilian election system works. And now you can see it's clear, it's straightforward, it's very easy to understand. It makes sure that people are given the time that they need in order to go and vote. It's fast and it's very convenient. And we've been doing this for over 20 years. But Bolsonaro, who still impresses me to talk while he has his mouth full of Trump's ball, started sowing doubt on the electoral system, much more like Trump did. And the problem here is that he involved the military on this. And if you're wondering, Luisa, why the fuck are you so concerned about the Brazilian military? Here's a story for you, okay? In 1964, the Brazilian military coup president João Goulart in a military civilian coup who was financed by, and you guessed it, this instituted a period of authoritarian repression that lasted from 1964 to 1985. This was a period where torture was widespread, and it was focused on the torture, persecution, and sometimes even murder of political dissidents and opponents. One of whom, by the way, was none other than President Dilma Rousseff herself. She was 19 when she was arrested, and she spent 3 years being tortured, which is why her teeth look like that, because they shifted in place in her jaw while she was being tortured. Yeah, she got fucked over by the US not once, but twice. Anyway, there's this really good author who I really, really like called Antonio Pereira, and he talks specifically about the way that Brazil worked with the military and the judiciary system before and after the democratization of Brazil. The Brazilian military regime used peacetime military courts to prosecute political dissidents and opponents without ever suspending the constitution. Torture was widespread, but disappearances were rare, and trials in military courts involved civilian participation on bench and at the bar, and left some room for the defense of the accused. courts issued death sentences in only 4 instances, and these were never carried out because they were reversed on appeal. But then, he also says, just as there was much legal continuity from democracy to authoritarianism, however, the transitions to democracy in the 1980s did not entirely dismantle the repressive legal apparatus that had been constructed under military rule. For example, the verdicts of the political trials in Brazil were never repudiated by the state, even after the transitions to democracy. Some of the laws on which the trials were based and the institutions that prosecuted and tried political defendants still exist. Looking at the trials helps us to understand exactly what has and what has not changed in the legal sphere as a result of democratization in Brazil and the Southern Cone, and to identify those vestiges of authoritarian legality that still exist there. Brazil adopted a form of dictatorship that Anthony Pereira says that was concerned with the appearance of legality, and thus he calls it an authoritarian legality. This was a system that was concerned in appearing democratic, not actually being a democracy, but appearing as if they were. For instance, the Brazilian military dictatorship had allowed opposition. So there were only 2 parties. One was the government party and one was the allowed opposition party. And when people said that this was not necessarily democratic, what they would say was, well, the United States only effectively has 2 parties and they are called a democracy. So we are a democracy. It's just that this is the way that our democracy works. The thing is, while this connection of the instituted powers with the military effectively saved lives because you couldn't have the level of political disappearances that happened in Argentina, because then that would shatter the idea of a legality, of the appearance of legality in the country. And so the people actually went to trials, and this effectively ended up saving their lives. On the other hand, and on the flip side, the familiarity between those 2 systems made it so that when the military dictatorship was over, it was almost like a gentleman's agreement that no one was going to be punished for what happened. And thus, Brazil had no effective transitional justice to speak of. And many of these people who did those things in the Brazilian military dictatorship are still alive and influential to this day. And this means that the Brazilian army has never stopped seeing itself as sort of a moderating power who could, if it wanted to, take power at any given point. And if it wants to, it could go back to a military dictatorship. It's almost as if Brazilians only have democracy because the Brazilian military allows them to, but it could change their mind at any second. And this is why the interference of the Brazilian military on the election in this past couple of years has been so jarring and so difficult to see. What Lula did was nothing short of a miracle. Brazil did not purge its institutions from its authoritarian past, and this is why Brazil still struggles with authoritarianism to this day. Bolsonaro is a far-right extremist not because he likes to suck Trump's dick. He is a far-right extremist because he openly defends the return of the military dictatorship. He has said with all letters that he's favorable to torture, and he also says that he is amenable to the torture persecution and murder of political opponents. In fact, some say that he's connected with the murder of Councilwoman Marielle Franco. And I have no evidence of this, but I have some conviction that it is. In fact, during Dilma's impeachment trial, he praised Colonel Ustra, who was actually the man who tortured Dilma during her arrest. This man is disgusting. It's not just because he shits by his nose sometimes. He's disgusting because he is a disgusting human being. To say what he said about the president during her impeachment trial, this is disgusting. He's a disgusting human being. With all of that out of the way, we can understand why we were all so concerned when Bolsonaro started involving the military in his bid to win the elections by cheating. Much like Trump in the US, he started saying that if he didn't win in the first round with over 60% of the vote, that there would be something very wrong with the Brazilian voting system, and that the fraud would be in the Superior Electoral Court. And in that sense, he actually pushed the military to start beefing with the president of the Brazilian Superior Electoral Court, and he himself started beefing with the president of the Brazilian Superior Electoral Court, who is none other than Xandão. Bolsonaro has had a bone to pick with Alexandre de Moraes since always. Alexandre de Moraes has been cracking down on fake news for a long time, and he has handed Bolsonaro some very difficult defeats in what it comes to his social media presence and his ability to spread fake news without actually being held accountable for it. The fact that Alexandre de Moraes was actually instrumental in making sure that this round of elections of 2022 actually happened. He did not give into any of the shenanigans that Bolsonaro and his team started to come up with. He really did not give in, and I think that it pains me to say it because I don't particularly like him as a justice. We owe a lot of our democracy and the way that our democracy is still standing to him. In the first round of the elections, when they came, Lula had 6 million votes more than Bolsonaro did. And Bolsonaro lost it.
Se vocês botarem um pinguço para dirigir o Brasil, um cara sem qualquer responsabilidade, que tem um rastro de corrupção, um rastro de deboche para com a família brasileira, de ataques a padres, a pastores, de ataque às Forças Armadas, de ataque aos policiais, vocês acham que vai dar certo? Vocês vão continuar com o emprego de vocês aí?
Is this a man who is confident that he was going to win the runoffs? Absolutely not. And so what followed were a bunch of desperate attempts to make sure that he was going to win the runoffs. His attempts to win the runoffs, or to cheat himself into winning the runoffs, were so fucking ridiculous that they were almost like fitting for a bad anime villain, because it's so fucking ridiculous. Oh my God. Let me just tell you guys. The best ones, okay? In no particular order. First thing, his communication minister said that his campaign didn't have the right amount of insertions in radios in northeastern Brazil. And this somehow would justify the postponing of the runoff vote. It gets worse. Actually, the Supreme Electoral Court went to check. They didn't actually have the necessary insertions. Do you know why? Because they actually didn't send the insertions to the radios, and so the radios had nothing to play. I shit you not, this is the country where I have been living for 4 years. One of his allies, Roberto Jefferson, or as we call him, Bob Jeff.
Os instintos mais primitivos.
He was in house arrest for making death threats against Supreme Court justices. Yes, he made some more nasty threats to a specific Supreme Court justice called Carmen Lúcia. And Alexandre de Moraes actually reversed his house arrest and had him be detained. When the agents of the federal police went there to detain him, he shot at them 40 times, and then he threw 2 grenades at them. What's a guy in house arrest doing with 2 grenades and 3 rifles? I don't have the answer either. Anyway, he almost killed 2 federal police officers, and so that didn't bode well for him at all. And then, like 2 or 3 weeks before the elections, at a time, might I add, where holding and carrying a gun is forbidden because of elections, one of Bolsonaro's closest allies called Carla Zambelli.
Carla Zambelli! Sim, o chefe tira a máscara, eu também tiro, sim.
She ran after a black man in the streets of São Paulo because he dared saying something that she didn't like. 2 days before the election. Okay? Okay. On election day, the Brazilian road police actually established several roadblocks in northeastern Brazil where Lula has the majority of the vote. And in order to stop completely or delay people from actually going to vote. This was a major scandal because the head of the federal road police in Brazil is a huge Bolsonaro supporter, and he was actually asking for votes for Bolsonaro the day before the election when it's forbidden to do so, mostly because he's a career official. He's not just appointed, he's a career official. He's not supposed to do that. And so he did, and then he ordered the blocks. And then a lot of people actually got late or gave up on voting altogether because of what he did. So that was a huge scandal when it happened. And all of this is not even to mention like the billionaire scheme that Bolsonaro did in order to buy votes for him and in order to have people be coerced into voting for him. Like, we're talking 400 billion reais from government money that was given to people in order to facilitate the purchase of votes. And after all of this, after the stealing and the complaining and the crying and the yelling and the robbing and all of that, after all of that, he's still fucking lost. And cheers to that. I will say, though, I felt a relief. Like, I was talking to my boyfriend about this. I felt for the first time in 4 years that I could take a deep breath. It's been very difficult 4 years, and especially with the pandemic, it's been so hard. It's been so difficult. And I lost people during this. And it's like I said, like, my uncle isn't coming back. He died alone in an ICU waiting for a vaccine that came way too late for him. He's not coming back. Like, I'm never going to see him again. He's gone. This man murdered my uncle. He made my uncle die alone in a hospital bed with a tube down his throat. There's nothing I can do that is going to bring him back, but at least his death wasn't in vain. At least there's a little bit of punishment for what he did. This man destroyed my family. What I was meant to say is that he didn't die in vain. And his death didn't mean nothing. It wasn't forgotten. And there were consequences. As little as they were, there were consequences for what Bolsonaro did to us. And when I got the election results, I cried. Like, when my uncle died, Bolsonaro was imitating people choking in COVID wards. It was like 3 days later when he did that. And I just kept remembering that my uncle always liked a full house with a lot of people. And he died alone. Oh, God. Jesus. I don't like talking about this much because I always end up crying because it's so unfair. But now I can safely say that it wasn't for nothing, and that there is still a little bit of justice in the world, and that everything that this man did will somehow come back to him. Apparently now he has a wound on his leg that he can't wear pants, so he's just walking around in his underwear because his leg is rotten, not including the fact that he sometimes shits by his nose because he eats too much stuff that he's not supposed to, and then he gets stuck and he can't poo, and then they have to pull the poo out by his nose. And so all of that is punishment, and I have to believe that it is punishment just so I won't go crazy. I have to believe that something will happen just so I won't go crazy, because these past 4 years have been so hard, have been so difficult. And when Lula got elected, I felt like I was, you know, that sense of relief. Like, oh, Jesus. Okay. Yeah, if you're wondering how that affected me personally, I'm very happy that Bolsonaro cannot wear pants. I'm just so, it's like, I haven't listened to a word that he said in 3 weeks. Like, no one told me, did you see what Bolsonaro said today? No one fucking said that to me in 3 weeks. This has been the best 3 weeks in a very long time. In a very, very, very long time. Anyway, after the elections, Bolsonaro supporters tried to close the roads and protest against election results, which is, anyway. They're also camping in front of army bases. Some people are very concerned about this. I decided that I'm not going to be concerned about this because what they want is media attention, and I don't want to give them any sort of actual serious coverage. I just want to make fun of them. And thankfully, the memes that they are producing are great. There was this one time that they sang the national anthem to a tire. And also there was this guy who tried to stop a truck from going forward on a block. And he held himself to the front of the truck, and the guy just like went over 100 miles with him holding in front of the truck. That was such a good meme. Anyway, if you're wondering also, Bolsonaro still hasn't conceded. That is irrelevant. Transition will move forward with or without him wanting to. So, with that all of the way, and the context of the elections out of the way, I want to examine three things. The first thing that I want to examine is how this election compares to the US election in 2020. And then I want us to think about what we can learn from this election. And finally, what can we expect from this third Lula term as leftists? So how does this compare to the 2020 elections? There was a far-right fascist challenged by, in his first re-election bid, by a guy who was very well known in politics. He lost by a small margin, and he started challenging the whole voting system, claiming that it was rigged and there was a whole mess. And in the words of the Bible, there was much weeping and gnashing of teeth. But in the words of good old Portuguese, dare I say, though, that's mostly where the similarities end. Because despite Bolsonaro wanting to play himself up as an outsider, the truth is that he was a low-level representative in the Brazilian House of Representatives for over almost three decades at the point where he got elected. In Brasilia, he had been irrelevant and had never pushed forward any legislation that has been actually approved. He was just suckling on the government's tits for 30 years and did nothing of relevance until he was elected president, on a far-right extremist rhetoric. So this says more about half of the population in Brazil than it says about his qualities and his ability as a politician or as a leader. He's just a lazy, corrupted official who bit more than he could chew with the presidency, and when stuff got rough, he called on the military to help him run the country because he himself cannot do it. The real differences, I think, lie in Lula and Biden, because Lula is currently one of the, if not the, biggest name of the left in the world. Lula was a metal worker who joined the metal workers union in 1968. And right at the beginning of the military dictatorship, this man spent the entirety of the military dictatorship being a thorn at the military's side. He was an organizer. He was a union leader. This was a man who has been doing union work and organizing since the 1960s, right? One of the reasons why he was so involved with union politics is because in 1964, he actually got his little finger trapped in a hydraulic press, and he lost that finger, which is why he doesn't have it if you look at any of his pictures. This is one of his defining characteristics. But what I want us to understand is that Lula is an extremely charismatic figure, which Biden really isn't, but also that Lula has been doing base organizing and community organizing since the 1960s, since before Biden was senator.
Todos nós sabemos que se a empresa, ou melhor, o empresário, não se dispuser a investir pouco de dinheiro para que a máquina tenha os seja adequada o suficiente para evitar acidente de trabalho, não adianta a empresa querer investir para que o homem use luvas, use capacete, use óculos de segurança, porque se é a medida paliativa. E às vezes um trabalhador está trabalhando com capacete, e em cima da cabeça dele está passando uma ponte rolante com algumas dezenas de toneladas. Às vezes o trabalhador está com uma luva na mão e tem que colocar a mão numa prensa de algumas toneladas também. Então, enquanto o empresariado não se conscientizar de que tem que investir, eu acredito que nós não teremos o fim do acidente de trabalho.
So, I want this to be very clear, that Lula had a leftist platform since the 1960s. Lula led strikes, he organized, he fought for workers' rights. He was actually down in the floor of the factory, in the streets with the people. He actually did this heavy organizing, and this is why he became this figure that is larger than life. It was, people were very much against him because of class reasons and racial reasons and xenophobic reasons, but he is still a figure that is, albeit controversial, a figure that is larger than what the actual person of Lula really is. And this is why Lula was the only one who could beat Bolsonaro. And this is also why I think his government will be effective in chasing Bolsonaro away for good. Not chasing the far right. These are two different things. I think that the far right in Brazil will organize itself, and that's very dangerous. But Bolsonaro, the person of Bolsonaro, I don't think that he's coming back to politics anymore. And this is the greatest difference. Some people call Lula a populist. I'm not exactly sure that actually helping people to leave extreme poverty should be called being a populist, but whatever. Lula has a very clear economic goal of ending poverty. He has a very clear economic goal of development in a sense that it needs people not to be hungry anymore. And those of us who grew up under a Lula presidency will remember a future, a past, really, where we had a future of great possibility. And nowadays, those possibilities are sort of shut off. And I think that what he wants with his third term is basically just bringing this hope again. And I think that he ran again because he knows that he still can do it. And he still can bring up this will that we had to hope for better things in the future, because right now our prospects are really bleak. And I think that what we can learn from this is that, one, nationalizing coherent election laws actually make it difficult for people to pull something like Trump wanted to pull. And this makes it so that the system works faster and less people have doubts in it. Not saying that I was going to be the one who's going to doubt the system in the United States. It's just that the system is so complex and so failable, and it takes so fucking long that it makes sense that people will have doubts about it, because it's not a good voting system. And I'm so very sorry to say that for those of you who are so in love with the American Constitution and voter system that you have your mouth full of the Founding Fathers' dick. But the thing is, when you have nationalized laws that are aimed at making the voting system as quick, easy, and as transparent as possible, people have more trust in the voting system. And so it becomes increasingly more ridiculous for Bolsonaro supporters to do what they're doing now, saying that they can't understand, that they can't vote, that they can't trust on the voting system, when even the majority of Bolsonaro voters actually said, you know what, it's okay, we lost, you know, life goes on. Second thing, base organizing and community organizing is the only possible way out to the left. And I say this because we experience the possibility of change, and we experience the possibility of taking out one of the greatest fascists, derogatory, that have ruled in Brazil by voting for a man that we know has this sort of transit with all people, and who is not only charismatic, but also understands the need that people have for food and for basic necessities on a deep level, because he himself experienced those. And he knows how to talk to these people. He knows how to convince those people. He knows how to be persuasive to these people. And this can only happen because we actually enjoy it, and we actually focus on base organizing and community organizing and being in the communities as leftists. So you'll always see leftist organizing and leftist organizations in the most impoverished, but also every single space where decisions can be taken, those people will be there. And I think that this level of organization is absolutely necessary to build a left that can establish itself as a powerful enough force that it can counterbalance this ridiculous resurgence of the far right around the world. And the third thing that I want to say is actually a song that I really like that says, "E os ventos do norte não movem moinhos." Basically, the winds of the north move no windmills. What I want to say with this is that the north has a lot to learn with the south. The way that we run our elections, the way that we run our organizing, there is no way forward for the left that in the global north that doesn't necessarily purpose learning with the global south what have we been doing to resist those far right offensives, because we have been doing this for way longer than you guys. So with that, all of that said, what can we expect of our Lula government? This is a government that is going to be center left and coalition. Lula himself said that this is not going to be a leftist government. This is going to be a coalition government, and this was a coalition that was designed and thought to put the country back on track after Bolsonaro. So this is a government that is going to focus on economic aspects, and it's going to focus on social development, but it's not necessarily a government where you're going to see such progressive necessities such as, for instance, the decriminalization of abortion and weed. It's not going to happen in this government, okay? This is going to be a center-left government focused on social aspects of the economy, but it's not going to be a government that is going to be very focused on very contentious social demands as abortion and drug control. So this is not going to be a government where we're going to see great advances in that, and that's where the left is important, to actually keep pressuring the government not to forget about this debate and actually balance out the debates and the discussions in Congress. Some of you may have seen that the Brazilian Congress is majorly conservative. It's not majorly conservative, it's majorly opportunist. They're going to vote with Lula if the need arises. I'm not. One day I'm going to make a video explaining all about Centrão. This is not going to be this video, I already talked too much. I don't think Lula is going to have that much of an issue to govern. That is, if he sticks to the actual thing of the social aspect of the economy, I don't think that he's going to have too much issue with that. If he tries to push some identitarian progressive issues, then I think that he's going to have more trouble. But I don't think that he's going to struggle a lot. He's a very skilled politician, and he knows how to deal with people. And so I think that he's going to find a best way to work around with a Congress that is not necessarily his fan. Lula already said that he's not running for a second term. He's going to be 81 by the time that he ends this term. And this man is tired. So I don't think that he's going to run for a second term, really. And so that leaves us with a vacuum on the left, because as I said, Lula is a figure that is bigger than himself. And because he is bigger than himself, that means that he sort of monopolizes all of the attention, and it's difficult for us to create figures on the left that has the sort of pull that Lula has while Lula is still alive. And so we have amazing people on the left in Brazil. We have Guilherme Boulos, Manuela Dávila, we have Marília do Rosário, we have Aurea Carolina, Thalíria Petroni, we have many names that are incredible on the left, but none of them has the pull that Lula has. And we have to recognize this. And we have to recognize that after Lula leaves, we're going to have a succession of center-right governments until we can actually come up with a coherent alternative for the left. And so that is going to take some time to organize. And I think that we should be very realistic in thinking that we are only going to be able to have a consistent leftist project back in government in Brazil in about 12 years. So we're looking at a 12-year development program for a new alternative in the left that we can rally behind and we can use to oppose the center-right, right-wing section of society that has taken power and that is together with Lula because they fought for democracy, but they are not necessarily aligned with us within the progressive camp. And so I think this is going to be our challenge after this Lula presidency, trying to find out a cohesive project of the left that doesn't rely on Lula. That is a big challenge for us in Brazil. A challenge bigger than what I can articulate, I would say. But so far, Lula has been invited for like many events in the international community. He's really concerned about the environment, and he is concerned with an environmental policy that has indigenous people at the forefront, which was something that I was not expecting, but it's really glad that it's done. We're going to have a ministry of originary people, and I think that that is going to make a huge difference in Brazil's environmental policies, which were non-existent for the past 4 years. But I think that now we're going to go back at having a very important position when it comes to issues of the environment and the defense of originary people of Brazil. So anyway, this is an ongoing development. I am going to put more updates about this on my Patreon if you're interested in following this development. And if something major happens, every once in a while, I'll go back here to YouTube to catch you guys up on what's going on and how the transition is going along. But I'm going to post more frequent updates on my Patreon page, so you can check that in the description below if you're interested in the topic. But yeah, that's it. Lula won. This has been Brazil. Fuck Bolsonaro. O meu presidente é Luiz Inácio Lula da Silva. Um brinde pra nós. And I'm finally sleeping better. And in the words of Cazuza,
o Brasil, o mundo. Ei, valeu, que o dia nasça lindo pra todo mundo amanhã, com o Brasil novo, com a rapaziada esperta. Valeu.
Anyway, this was today's video. I hope you guys enjoyed it, and I'll see you guys next time. Bye!